Okay, what's going on, everybody? My name is Mang. Welcome back to Board Manging, my desperate attempt to cover video or board games in some fashion. And today we're going to be talking about BattleCON War of Indines. This is the kind of remastered edition of the original War of Indines set that came out a little while back. But what I'm going to be talking about also can cover Devastation of Indines, which is the big set, and Fate of Indines, which is the upcoming kind of beginner's starter set. And BattleCON is a kind of a fighting simulator, you might say, for two or more players, although I've only played it with two, in which you are going to take control of a colorful cast of characters who each kind of have their own moveset and identity and powers and things like that, and you're going to do basically like a fighting match, like a 2D or, you know, like a fighting video game, but in card form. So I'm going to show you how it plays, and then I'm going to go through a bit of a match between me and my mom that I recorded. And then we're going to come back and I'm going to tell you what I think about all of it. So let's get started to show you how exactly BattleCON plays out, because it is pretty cool. Alright, so I'm going to be showing you specifically what you get in the remastered War of Indines set. And then I'll kind of go over a basic overview of how gameplay works, just so you get an understanding of how it flows. So you're going to get the game board. As depicted here, it's not too large, because it's, again, it's just to simulate a 2D fighting system. So pretty much you just have the movement spots here where your characters are going to be situated. You've got kind of a beat sequence for every turn, so you can kind of follow along with that if you don't remember. And then you just got discard piles, which we'll talk about. Okay, so you're going to be also with that. You're gonna get some paper materials. You've got the rule book here, which is it's hefty. It kind of, yeah. I mean, a lot of this is just kind of rule clarifications, and they do kind of a comic book style how to play and things like that, which is pretty useful. Just covering to make sure that every situation is accounted for and things like that. There are some terms that you'll need to remember and blah blah blah. Then they also have a fighter and mode guide. This is a smaller book that's going to mention every character that's in the War of Indines set. Mention their difficulty, what they're good at, what they're bad at, and, you know, show what is part of each of their set. So what cards or tokens you're going to need for each of them. And then you also get this very large poster. I'm not going to unfurl the whole thing, but it has art and names for every character in the whole BattleCON system. So they have Fate of Indines, War of Indines, and Devastation of Indines. So if you're really interested, you can hang this up, and the backside is just kind of a art piece between Cadeza there and, I don't remember her name, Katsumi? That's probably not right. I think the little guy's name is Jumo, but I digress. Anyways. So, then the actual characters. The game comes with these little kind of pouches. You can see here, it has their name, their full name, their class, their difficulty, what is part of the whole kit, and it's got their artwork on it, and it's just kind of a little pouch that you put all their cards to kind of keep it sorted, which is very useful. It's not a perfect system, though, for organizing everything, because there's enough room in here for the cards and for their standee. I can bring it out here. Every character has one of these little cardboard stands that go in a little thing, and they sit on the board and blah blah blah. And so they just have the artwork on there. There's Hikaru. And so, yeah, these little pouches have room for their cards and their stand. But unfortunately, a lot of characters have tokens involved with them. And there's a whole bunch of tokens in the game. You can see there's There's a lot of tokens involved in the whole game. So, it doesn't really all fit together well in these pouches without just, like, breaking them. And, it's a little annoying, so I just keep the tokens all in that one little bin, separate, and just, you dig them out whenever you're ready to play with a character. But, a lot of people have come up with some very good storage solutions, and if I were to buy, like, another set, like Devastation of Indines or Fate of Indines, like, I would really have to think about a better storage solution, but for now it works okay with just War of Indines. Okay, so, we're gonna go through Hikara, we're gonna explain that, and he has these four tokens, for Fire, Earth, Water, and Wind. And, okay. I forgot something. Oh, alright, I'll grab that. And let me just grab this. Okay. So, when you're going to pick a character, and there's three different difficulties of characters. There's kind of basic, intermediate, and advanced, and it divides it out for you. So, very useful when you first start playing to definitely pick a basic character. Even if you're pretty familiar with a lot of modern board games and stuff like that, it doesn't hurt to just start with somebody from the basic set. And you're going to be putting together these little wheels, very common in a lot of Fantasy Flight stuff and things like that. And this is your health tracker. So you see there at the top, that is your health. You start at 20 health, and it ticks all the way down to zero, blah, blah, blah. The inside wheel is for focus, which is used for a variety of special effects, but we're not really going to be talking about that because we're going to keep it basic. And regardless of what character you're going to pick, you're going to get the same six base cards. And so they are Strike, Burst, Drive, Dash, Shot, and Grasp. So every character, regardless of who you're playing, is going to get these six cards. They have blue backs, and these are your bases. And each character is also going to have their own unique base. Hikaru's unique base is Palm Strike. Okay? And so the bases, most of them are, you know, kind of general to everybody. And these kind of form the basics of your combat abilities. Hence why they're called bases. And they are modified by styles, which are unique to every character. Every character has five of them, usually, I think. And so Hikaru's styles are Trance, Advancing, Geomantic, Focused, and Sweeping. Alright? So what you're going to do every round is you're going to be picking two of these. Well, you're going to be picking one base and one style, and you're going to be putting them together. So you're going to pick this hidden from your opponent, and I'll explain what all the numbers mean, but you're going to pick one blue back and one red back, so one base, one style, and so you might just pick, you know, like this, and you're going to put it face down, and this. Okay. And so you're going to flip it, you're going to reveal at the same time, and you're going to show, okay, this is what I got. I have Geomantic Strike. And so a lot of the names of the abilities do come together and they sound cool. Some of them don't sound like they make much sense, but anyways. So, okay, Geomantic Strike. So at the actual sequencing of things, I'm not going to go into great detail. I'm not Rodney Smith. I'm not really going to teach you how to play. I'm just going to give you an overview. So you're going to look at priority first. That's that yellow number. So all your bases, this one, is going to have usually like a regular number, and then the styles are usually going to have a modifier, a plus or a minus. So you add it together, and this could be a positive number, a negative number. For this one, Geomantic Strike, it's a +3, or just a 3. And you're going to compare that to the opponent, and whoever has a higher number is going to go first for this round. And a lot of cards have different effects, and they let you move either before you activate or after you activate, or at the start of the beat or at the end of the beat. They use the word beat basically for turn, pretty much. And every card is going to have a range. And again, it's much like priority. For the base is going to have a solid number, and the style is going to modify it. So for the Geomantic Strike, it has a range of 1. Which means that Basically, you have to be right next to the opponent. I'll just use these. So if I'm here, my opponent has to be within one range, so he has to be pretty much right there. We have to be next to each other for that to hit. This would be 2 range, 3 range, 4 range, so on and so forth. You get the idea. It's not a huge board, but a lot of characters, or some characters, don't really have much range to their abilities. So maneuvering, you know, next to your opponent or away from your opponent is a big part of the game for being, you know, in the range that you want to be, whether that is up close or far away. And then the power is how hard you hit with a general attack. So strike is going to be one of your harder hitting bases, and this adds 1 to it, so you're going to hit for 5 damage if you hit. And there's no like randomness to it, there's no luck. If you are within range, you are not stunned, you pretty much hit them. There's no dodging or anything like that. So a big part of the game then is stunning. If you go first for a beat and you hit the opponent and they don't have anything to really protect themselves, they get stunned, which means that their turn is basically skipped. They don't get to go. So going first is very huge unless you have protection from it. So here the strike base, which everybody has stun guard 5. Which means that you can take up to 5 damage on your turn without getting stunned. Now if you go first and then your opponent goes and they hit you, you don't get stunned because you already went. So stun guard and things like that, stun immunity, only matter if you're going second and you want to prevent being stunned. Okay. So yeah, it becomes a big part of figuring out what your opponent has in their hand and what they're going to play and what they're planning on doing on their turn, because you could be, just with the bases, if I can show you that, ignoring the unique one, you have Burst here, which has a range of 2 to 3 and lets you retreat 1 or 2 spaces at the start of the beat. Drive, which is pretty similar but lets you advance 1 or 2 spaces. Dash, which is an interesting one because this never attacks anybody. This is not used to attack. But if you... it has a 9 priority though, so you're likely to go first. And if you move past an opponent with the movement, they are not allowed to hit you that turn. So this is kind of like your recharge or your positioning kind of ability because it's likely to go first. Shot is your range 1 to 4. Stun guard 2. Grasp has 5 priority, which is pretty good. And on hit, it lets you move the opponent 1 space, so you can position them better, or position them maybe outside of their range. And the unique stuff always does kind of weird things, unique to the character. So, taking a look at Hikaru right here, every character is going to have a reference sheet, a reference card, which lists all their different styles, as well as their unique base and their finishers. And so at the start of a round, you're going to give this to your opponent usually so they can look over this and they see everything that you do. So there's no real secrets involved. And they also, every character gets this kind of cool artwork card. You see that, Hikaru Soyama. He's a geomancer apparently, although he geomances with his fists. Kind of like in Resident Evil 5, I guess. And then it kind of gives a kind of a reference for how they what their special ability is. And so Hikaru's special thing is he gets 4 elemental tokens: fire, water, wind, and earth. And so tokens are usually used during the anti-step. So what you're going to do is you're going to pick secretly your style and your base, your attack pair. And then once both players have picked secretly, then you're going to go to the anti-step. And so this is where you're going to go back and forth and anti tokens. A lot of characters can only anti one. Some characters don't get to anti anything ever. But Hikaru can anti these 4. He can only do 1 per round unless he has a special thing, but during the anti step it's only 1. And these kind of give him special things, like fire increases the power for his that turn by 3, which is pretty good. Wind increases his priority by 2. Water basically increases his range. And earth gives soak 3. Soak 3 just means he takes 3 less damage from any attack that round, that beat. And so during the anti-step, you know, it's basically, you know, one player is going to say, okay, I'm going to do soak 3. And then the other player, if they have things they can ante, they can choose to or not. And so this token is going to, this ability is going to take effect during this beat. And then after it's over, you're just going to put it aside. And so every character has kind of their own way potentially to get it back. So Hikaru's way of getting it back is here, this trance style. So if he uses this, which is not a very good style, it only increases his range, doesn't give him any power or priority. But on reveal, or on end of beat, he gets to regain an elemental token of his choice. So he gets one back. Reveal, which means when he reveals this card, return all elemental tokens anti this beat to your token pool. You do not gain their anti effects during this beat. So that's kind of part of the bluffing aspect of the game, which is pretty strong. So as part of my bluff, I might put in like the power one or something, like as in, you know, I'm going to put on the hurt this turn. So somebody else might anti something that's a bit more defensive to retaliate, but then I play the trance thing and I just pull it back. I was bluffing, you know, something like that. There's a lot of bluffing aspect to the game. Okay, so you do your anti once everyone's done anti, and then you both reveal your attack pairs, and you do any reveal effects, and you compare your priority to see who's higher, who's going first. Then you do any start of beat effects. Then you do any before activating effects. Then you do your activation, which means movement and attacking or any other stuff that's going on. You do any after activating effects. And then if the other player has not been stunned, they get to do their before activating effects. They get to do their activation, then the after activating effects, and then the end of beat stuff. It sounds like a lot of steps, but really once you know what you're doing, once you get how the flow is, it goes pretty quickly, because it's just like, well, you know, I don't have a lot of this. I don't have any before activating or before a start of beat or blah, blah, blah. So it goes fairly quickly. Sorry. So then after both people have attacked and maybe, you know, some health has gone down and blah, 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 then you're going to cycle. You're going to recycle. So you're going to take, at the start of the game, you're going to put one style and one base in these discard piles over here. And they have recommended ones that you put in each of these piles at the start of the game, but you can put whatever you want. So after each turn, you're going to take your attack pair that you used, and you're going to take this pile into your hand. You're going to move this pile over, and you're going to put the one you just used and put it here. So you're going to keep cycling through the cards in your hand. So you're only going to have, at any given time, maybe three styles and four or so bases. So your options aren't huge, but among those, you know, among that hand, you could combine a bunch of them. And so it's good that you're not overwhelmed by options, but that also leads to a lot of the strategy of the play, where you're trying to figure out which one of those few options is my opponent going to do and how can I best counter that. And gameplay continues going until one player reaches zero health or until you go through 15 beats, in which case it's decided by whoever has more health. A lot like, you know, a fighting game. So the final thing then is the finisher move. And so each character has this finisher card, which is double-sided. So you can pick either one. Although I guess at the start of the game, players have to decide whether they're using A or B. A or B. Kind of a funky B. So it's not like a total surprise. Like, again, there aren't really any surprises. Like, you can't say, oh, I'm going to use A, and then really, oh, look at this B! You know, you people have to know what you're doing. So there aren't really any surprises in the game. So you can only use finishers when you are at 7 or lower health, and you have to use kind of a special card. I haven't actually used a finisher in the game because my mom hasn't totally grasped the system yet, but from what I understand, you have to be at 7 or lower health. I think focus plays into it. I'm not sure. I'm not Rodney Smith. And you can pull out these huge finishers. It's like this one, priority 6, power 7, wrath of elements. If this hits, it's, you know, boom. And you discard all the elemental tokens in his attack pool and applies them to his attack. So it's a finisher for a reason. And so each character has their own couple finishers, and they're all really cool, very thematic, and that's pretty much it. So now I'm going to show you a bit of gameplay from an actual match. I'm going to go through just the final beat of the game. It wasn't a very long one. It wasn't a very long match. I'm going to go through the final beat, and I'm going to kind of narrate what is going on, because the actual commentary of us playing is not very exciting. So let's take a look at that so you can get a final understanding of how the game plays.
All right, so yeah, as I said, we're just going to be going over the last beat of this match between myself and my mom. And she was playing as Hikaru, which I kind of already talked about. He is a very, very balanced fighter that can put out some heavy hits, but is pretty quick on his feet. He has a lot of higher priority moves. And his special thing is the elemental tokens that give him a variety of different basic effects, such as plus to power, plus soak, or plus range, or plus priority. And I was playing as an intermediate fighter called Rukyuk, I think. That's how I pronounce it. And Rukyuk is kind of basically like a sniper. He uses a gun, and so his special thing is he has ammo tokens, and his ammo tokens function a lot like Hikaru's elemental stuff. So they give, like, plus to power, or plus to range, or plus to priority, or they, like, push the opponent when they hit. He has six of them, and they all do different kind of things. And so he has to ante one of these every turn if he wants to actually attack the opponent. So in this way, he could, like, yeah, I mean, if you don't ante it as some sort of weird bluff, then you can't attack, but then that's probably is when you use a dash move, so you're not intending to attack, but, yeah. So, so he has these six things, and so once your six tokens are used, then you need to use his reload base in order to get all the tokens back. And so at this point in the match, I had just used reload, and so I had gotten all my tokens back. So you have a lot of options when you do that, like at the start of the game or when you reload, you have a lot of options available to you. But when you're down to like your last ammo token, you know, you could reload or you could try to just use that last one and do a hit, but your opponent kind of knows what you're going to be doing. And so I had just gotten all my ammo tokens back, and my opponent, I think, only had one elemental token, which was plus two priority. So I was fairly confident that she was going to use that, because she tends to use her tokens pretty freely. And, she was down to 7 health. I believe I'm down to 9 health at this point. So, with her bonus to priority, I was fairly confident that she was going to go first. And so I wanted to pick a combo that was not likely to go first, but dependent on going second and, you know, doing something well with it. And so I know that Hikaru's range is not that great. And so I think she tends to be greedier than she should be, so I think she did have the shot base, so she could have shot me, potentially stunned me, but she didn't. So I kind of banked on that. I was hopeful. So what I played was Crossfire Burst, which can pretty much hit the entire board. It's got big range, and but I really wanted to just end it with this. So I ante the explosive shot token, which gives plus two power, and the crossfire special thing is when you hit, you can spend another ammo token to give it another two power. So that's 7 total attack, which would kill her if she has no soak. And I don't think she has any soak except for her earth token, which was not available to her. So that was going to be my hit. But the burst part was to retreat a little bit, just in case she did, like, a drive. So that got her to advance forward, which is what she wants to get in front of me, get in my face so she can hit me with range 1, which is most of her stuff unless she shoots me or does a burst. So I was banking on just getting out of there, avoiding the strike, and then shooting her for the final kill. The Crossfire also has Soak 2, which may have covered my ass, but that would have to be a really weak hit. Like, usually hits are for a bit more than 2 most of the time, but it might have helped, might have saved the day. But she did kind of play very predictingly and used Sweeping Drive, which has huge priority, priority 7 total. So, yeah, she was with her plus 2 priority from the thing. She was guaranteed to go first, which I think is what she was hoping. And so the Sweeping Drive is not very powerful, however. It was only going to do 2 power, so this was not going to end the game for her. And with my Soak 2, it wouldn't have stunned me. So either way, I was probably going to be okay. But it does only have range 1. So the drive part would put her next to me. However, this is where the interesting part of the steps of the process go. So drive happens before activation, which means when your character is ready to activate, that's when the drive happens. Burst, though, is start of beat. So start of beat is before either character activates, technically. So start of beat happens before activating. It sounds kind of complicated. It's not. So start of beat happens first. So I retreated. She tried to advance. And she just couldn't quite make it to me because I retreated too. She advanced too, and she was still out of range. And so if she had just had a little extra range, she could have hit me, potentially, you know, maybe with a little more power, possibly hurt me. And stunned me and kept the match going. But I was out of her range, so it went to me. I anteed, you know, I threw in the other ammo token. I did my 7 attack and knocked her out. And so that's kind of how the game goes, is this very kind of just, there's almost like a chess-like aspect to it where you're really thinking about not only what you're going to do, but really what your opponent is planning on doing next, you know. That's a big part of it. It gets kind of mental. It's really cool. It's really great. There's an intensity to it. My mom is not the greatest of opponents because she doesn't really get the strategy to it. Like, she would never be a chess master or anything like that. But it is a very elegant design. So yeah, it wasn't the greatest gameplay demonstration, but I kind of just wanted to walk you through a final turn just to show you some of the thoughts that go into it.
All right. So hopefully by this point you have a decent understanding of how BattleCON works, how it plays out, and you probably kind of already know whether you're interested or not. But if you are interested, in my opinion, you're watching this video, so I'm going to assume you are. I like it quite a bit. It is probably one of my favorite two-player games at this point. I don't find the system itself that complicated. I think once you get it, you get it, and from there, it's really just a fantastic framework for everything else that they do with it. Each character feels very unique. The robot, you know, Sir Daza or whatever he's called. What is he called? Cadenza. That's what it is. Cadenza, the big slow robot, feels when you're playing like a big slow robot, and you have to account for that. Whereas if you're playing somebody like Hikaru. Who's kind of the quick little Ryu-type fighter, he's, you know, it feels like that. And so you have to take into account your own capabilities in the fight, what you're good at, what you're weak at, and you have to look at what your opponent is good at and what they're weak at, and you kind of have to adjust for that. So you might stick with just one fighter, and your playstyle needs to kind of vary a bit when you're playing up against, you know, the big slow guy or a fellow, or like a ranged fighter or something like that. So it has a lot of potential, and, you know, just getting a box set like this, the new War of Indines set, which comes with, like, 21 different fighters, I think. No, 18 different fighters, that's it. 18 different fighters. I mean, you have a lot of potential playtime, a lot of variety, replayability just with this set. I'm really interested, like, I want to get all the sets, even though I've only played with like 3 or 4 different fighters so far. The framework is very exciting, and, you know, once you're kind of in the thick of it, yeah, it's just all clicking and it works really well. So I like it quite a bit as a two-player game. I don't know how it would really work with more than 2. They have kind of like a tag team system where you kind of tag in another person, but Yeah, I mean, I'm fine with just as a two-player game. I think it's very good. But you do kind of need somebody else, like a lot of two-player games, you need somebody else that is kind of invested in learning it and understanding it, and it wants to be on your level. Because I think if you kind of just... I think an experienced player, it's one of those games where an experienced player will beat a new player every single time. There isn't really elements of, like, luck involved in the game much. It's kind of, you know, there's the bluffing element, and there's kind of the figuring out what moves your opponent is going to play, because you have your opponent's reference sheet, so you know all their possible moves. You can see what's in their discard piles, you know, what they have in their hand and things like that. So you know what they're likely to play, but you got to play around that. And you're like, are they going to do that? Because you know that, you know, there's a lot of that kind of elements, but there isn't really kind of randomness to it. So for that reason, an experienced player is going to win every time. So you need an opponent that is going to kind of be on your level. So that is a potential downside, but overall, I mean, the two-player games, or a lot of games that I like, tend to have that kind of, you know, skill level to it. You know, I don't really love just luck fests, and, you know, BattleCON is not a luck fest, and so that's why it's one of my favorite two-player games so far, of which there are not many on that list, because I'm not a huge fan of a lot of two-player games. But, yeah, I'll definitely play BattleCON just about any time, so... there's my video about it. Again, if it piqued your interest, if you just want to get, you know, just try it out for the cheapest possible entry, I recommend looking for Fate of Indines, which should be out fairly soon. But if not, War of Indines, the remastered edition, just came out for about 30-some bucks. You can pick it up, get 18 fighters, plenty of playability, and in my opinion, it is very much worth it. So there you go. That is BattleCON War of Indines. My name is Mang. This has been Bored Manging, and I'll see you fine folks around.